It's a pleasure to welcome you all to worship here this morning at St. Stephen's. And if you're online, it's a pleasure to welcome you virtually, and I hope virtuously today. Let's join together as I lead us in our call to worship. I will exalt the Lord at all times. His praise will continuously be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Put aside the cares, the struggles, the successes, and the failures of the past week. Begin the new week, worshiping our Lord. Let us worship together. And we'll do so in our first hymn, which is Morning Has Broken. And let's join our hearts together in prayer. Shall we come before God? God, who is the Creator, we come before you this morning and we worship you. We take the time to think of this beautiful world that you have made in its startling and amazing diversity. And we love this country and this part of the country, and we're glad for the rain that fell in the night and the sun that is shining right now. We thank you for the birds that sing. We thank you for the animals hidden by the forest and those in our homes in plain view. We thank you for the flowers that adorn our gardens and this city. We thank you for all of it. And we don't just thank you, but we pause to reflect at how it reveals you, the Creator. You are powerful, as is nature. You are beautiful and intricate and mysterious. as is nature. You sustain us in our spirits, and you have provided the fields and the waters and the land to feed us and sustain us. We thank you for all this, and we worship you, God, who is creator. We also worship you this morning and thank you for being God, our Redeemer, the one who loved us in spite of ourselves, so much that you came into our reality through your Son, Jesus, to be our Savior, to give himself in life, and then ultimately to give his life in death, that we might live. And we thank you that you exercised your power back then in bringing Jesus alive again, and that this is a foretaste of what we too will experience who put our trust in you, who believe that Jesus is our Savior, that even though we die one day, yet we will live in your presence, in your company. And we thank you, God, who is spirit, that while we do not see you, we see your footprint, we see your finger marks, we see your presence all around us if we will look. And we thank you that you have come among us by your spirit, because we gather today in the name of Jesus and we claim the promise that where a few are gathered, and we include those who are online this morning among us, gathering in your name, and you by your spirit are with us. Help us to worship you this morning, as with all your people right around the globe this day, that we might glorify you, that we might learn from you, that we might go from this place strengthened by you. And we pray together now in the words that our Savior taught his disciples to pray when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." God calls us together to worship him, and he gives us the assurance of his love and of new continuing life in Jesus Christ, and we give him our thanks. I'll call on Nancy now to come and update us on the life of the church.
Thank you, Ian. And good morning, everyone. It's nice to see quite a few people in the church today on such a hot summer day. Welcome, everyone, to worship this morning. Also, welcome to all who are worshiping with us online. We're glad that you could be with us. As many of you know, Meg Patterson is on vacation right now. We trust that she's having a restful and relaxing week, and we pray that she will come back to us refreshed for the service next week. If there are any pastoral emergencies, please contact your elder. I need to now thank and welcome back Ian Shugart, who has kindly agreed to take the service in Meg's absence this week. We're delighted to have him back worshiping with us again today and leading us in worship. For those of you who may not know Ian, I'll point to a short biography that he provided. He is well known to our church, to St. Stephen's, having served in the pulpit during a three-year vacancy. A career public servant, Ian and his wife Linda raised their three children in Ottawa, and they attend, or he attends and his wife, St. Paul's Presbyterian Church. So welcome, Ian. We're so glad to see you again today. I would like to thank the helpers who are helping me out with the worship service today. By the way, if anyone doesn't know me, my name is Nancy McEwen, and I've had some helpers today. Jen Chalmers, who had to leave a little earlier, set up our AV system, and Dan Lavoie, thank you for manning the AV system through the service this morning. Also, a special word of thanks to Peggy Jenkins for leading us in the music for the service today. The only announcement I have, really, is that next Sunday, worship will be here at St. Stephen's again with Meg back in the pulpit. I wanted to let you know that her message will be concerning a study of the young adult novel entitled The Marrow Thieves, written by Cherie Dimeline, who is a Métis Canadian. Now, you don't have to read the book to come to church next week, okay? So you can come and hear her speak on themes of a world, a kind of a negative worldview after the impacts of climate change. I think it deals with climate change and Indigenous matters. So it sounds like it would be a fascinating service next week, so I hope you can join us then. That's all I have for today. Our next hymn will be hymn number 252, He is Lord. Please stand and join the singing of this hymn if you're able.
So because this hymn is so short, we're going to sing it through three times.
Our scripture lessons this morning, first from the Old Testament, we will be reading Psalm 42. This is entitled, For the Director of Music, a Maskil of the Sons of Korah. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. My soul is downcast within me. Therefore, I will remember you from the land of the Jordan, the heights of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep. In the roar of your waterfalls, all your waves and breakers have swept over me. By day, the Lord directs his love. At night, his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying to me all day long, where is your God? Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Our New Testament lesson today is a change from the original plan. We made a substitution from a Matthew scripture that might be on the screen, but I don't see it on the screen, Dan, but I guess maybe it's not on the screen. Okay, so then nobody has to know that we made this substitution. I'll be reading from Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 to 17. This is entitled, Living as Those Made Alive in Christ. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Nancy. I won't ask for a show of hands.
test. Maybe it was the pulpit mic that we were hearing before.
Or maybe this is that button now too.
Sorry about this, folks. How's that? No difference? It says low battery. I'm going to preach from the pulpit, and that'll just make things easier. I won't ask for a show of hands because we have friends online, but I hope you're familiar with Wordle. I see some recognition. Wordle is a game that has become very, very big. It's owned by the New York Times, and every day some genius at the New York Times comes up with a word consisting of five letters, and you have six attempts to guess or work out what the word is. And you make a guess, you type it in your computer, and it will, if it's right the first time, which never happens, of course, each of those letters will show up as green. Any correct letter in the right place shows up as green. If you get the letter right, but it's in the wrong place, it shows up as yellow. And if the word does not have the letter, it shows up as gray. And don't bother guessing another word with that letter because the word does not have that letter. So after your first guess, you usually have one or two or maybe three letters to play with. You either got it right in the right location, or you got the letters in the word, but you need to change the location in your next guess. You with me? The first word is critical because that word will show how many letters you've got to play with. Now, it might matter and it might not matter, but my wife and I, who cheat and play Wordle together, work on that first word. What's our word today going to be? And the other day, we used the word since. And it turned out to be a really good guess because I think there were three letters that were going to be in the final correct word. It has two vowels, since, and three common consonants. And those are the things that you try in your first outing with Wordle. It turns out that the word since is a really critical, useful word in our passage today as well. Paul begins with the word since. Since you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is. Since in Paul's writings, or therefore, are words that are often a bridge between what has gone on before and what Paul is talking about next. It's his way of linking big ideas. And just as in Wordle the other day, since was critical, so too in this passage. Since is a really important idea that I want us to get in our heads right at the beginning. What I'm talking about today is the implications of Jesus' resurrection, the life that we have in Jesus for every day of our lives. That the resurrection is not just something on a calendar that we observe once a year, and we look forward to it, and we enjoy the glow of the resurrection of Easter Sunday for a while afterwards, but all the time since we have been raised with Christ, set your heart on him. Now, I'm going to ask four or five questions. And by the way, when you're studying the scriptures, asking a question is a useful trick for getting at the point of the scriptural passage, particularly when we come to Paul's writings, which can be dense and difficult. First question is, and you will have noticed from Nancy's reading of this passage in Colossians 3, the first question is, why should we live a certain way? It sounded as though Nancy was laying down a bunch of behaviors, a bunch of rules for us. Well, are we just supposed to follow orders? Is that what this is about, that the Christian life is just one of following orders and obeying because we have been told to by someone admittedly with ultimate authority? But is that what this is about? The answer to that question is no. It is true that our life should be one of obedience to the will and the purposes of God. But Paul has something else in mind here, something much more motivating, something much more alive. Since you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above. Set your hearts on Christ. It is the result, it is the implication of the resurrection that we live in a certain way. Not because we are just instructed to live a life of rules. Since we have been raised with Christ, set your minds, set your hearts on him. Paul is saying that this is the motivator. This is the reality that is now behind everything in our lives. And turning it around the other way, if we do not live this way, we are doing one of three things. We're saying we don't believe that the resurrection of Jesus has any implications going forward. Or we deny the power of the resurrection in our lives, that these might be ideals, but we're kind of helpless. Or we're admitting that the reality of the resurrection is not part of our own individual experience and decision-making. So to claim to be a follower of Jesus, but not to focus on him, is really saying, well, I don't really believe it. Or it's a nice thought, but I don't think it has any power. Or it's really not my story after all. But if we are followers of Jesus, however fresh, however new, however faltering, however weakly, we do that. Since we have been raised with Christ, along with him, set your hearts and minds where he is. The second question is this. Well, is this just a recipe? Is this just an invitation to live a life of daydreaming? That being a Christian is going off into a daze and just like thinking about heaven and wondering what it'll be like and when it will be? And no. Of all of the characteristics of Paul's letters in the New Testament, I think we'd have to say that Paul is very realistic. Paul is very real life. Paul speaks to our experience day to day of our work, of how we relate in our families, of how we get along with our neighbors, of how we deal with opposition or suffering, of how we plan our week, of doing the groceries and tending the garden. Paul is very practical, and so too is this passage. Since you've been raised with Christ, set your heart on things above does not mean that we exit from the world. It means that this is our priority, this is our focus as we live in the world. The resurrection is for every day of the year. Third question, what are these pictures, these references that Paul has to putting to death? And it sounds like he's talking about clothes, putting clothes off and putting clothes on. Well, there are two pictures. One is, in fact, putting something to death. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. And he goes on to mention those. And then later on, he says, do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self. Both of these are pictures of the old and of the new. You know those before and after pictures. You get them on advertisements in print or on the internet or TV. And this is what the person looked like before their hair implant or their weight loss plan or whatever it was. And this is what they look like now. And my goodness, life is wonderful now. You can just tell. This is before you became a follower of Jesus. The old life, the things that used to characterize your life, put those to death. And this is what your new life in Christ should look like. The image of death and life is not a particularly pleasant one. But let's realize that the story of Jesus culminates in death and life. And I put it deliberately in that order. As we live our lives, our story culminates in our life and our death. Well, Jesus changed all that because he came alive again. And Paul says at the beginning, since you have been raised with Christ. When we believe that the story of Jesus is his coming into the world to save, to take our place, to offer his life in place of ours, to pay the penalty of sin that should be ours, every human being, then we identify with him. And of course, nothing happens physically, but in our mind, in our spirit, God counts that, our identifying with him, as the equivalent event, dying spiritually to that old life. And as Jesus replaced or followed his death with his resurrection, we also have been raised with him spiritually in faith. And one day, of course, it will be true literally and physically in our new resurrection body. Jesus is called the first fruits. He's today's engineering kind of society. I suspect he would be called the prototype. He's the forerunner. He's the alpha model of the new software. He's the prototype of the new machine. And we are what is going to follow. We are going to experience that same thing. So in putting to death those old ways, Paul is saying it's only logical that as Jesus died to sin, not his, but ours, so you too died with him. Therefore, leave those other things dead, put them to death. And changing the analogy to clothes, it's like taking off the old rags of sexual sins and of slander and of malice and of anger and of covetousness. Take off those clothes, burn them. He doesn't say that, but I'm adding to the analogy. And put on the new wardrobe. It's just the logical extension of the resurrection of Jesus. And you see where I'm going, that this is not an annual celebration. This is all the time. It's the consequence, it's the implications of the resurrection of Jesus. Now, Paul likes lists, and we can repeat any number of times this list as though it's a catalog of behaviors. But try not to think of it that way. Think of it as a portrait of the earthly values and the values of the kingdom. Think of it as a portrait of me in my natural, un-Christian, un-Christ-like behavior. Quick to anger, bearing grudges, lustful, greedy. That's me in my natural state. But when I follow and when I reflect on and when I make Jesus my priority and when I let his spirit come into my life and I absorb his spirit and we talk and we live together, then I become more and more like Christ. I reflect more and more the image of God the Creator, loving, peaceable, generous, patient, kind. Yes, it's described as a list. But these are characteristics, these are the values of the kingdom of God. Fourth question, is there any relevance for the church, for the body of Christ together, or is this just for me as an individual? We are here together, after all, as the people of St. Stephen's. And I include our brothers and sisters watching. We are here all together as the church. And of course, the church is broader than this congregation. Ultimately, the church is global. So is there anything in this for the church, or is this just something that we come together to get instruction and then we go off and leave? Well, it's very much for the life of the church. Think of this verse later on, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. It's plural. This is not when you're burdened, when you're worried, when you're anxious, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. That's true, but that's true from elsewhere in the New Testament. It's not true from this passage. Of course, it's true, the peace of Christ can't be chopped up like slices of pastrami at the butcher's. I'll take four slices of individual peace of Christ and I'll take eight slices of collective for the body of Christ's peace. No, it's the peace of Christ. But let me ask you this. As a body of believers, when you disagree with one another, how well do you do that? when something goes wrong and somebody says something or does something or forgets something and it's taken amiss, or maybe it's taken correctly, but how do you deal with that? Here's the answer. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. This is what we were called to, unity, because Christ died for all of us. Christ came alive again for all of us. And notice the word rule. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, because you were called together as one body. You know, like any good parent, there's that blend in God, in our Lord Jesus, of toughness and real seriousness combined with gentleness and kindness. And it's all wrapped up in love. The peace is gentleness, and it's forgiveness, and it's kindness, and it's patience. All those soft edges. But Jesus looks at us a little bit sternly and he says, let my peace rule among you. And then Paul says, and let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Again, it's plural. By all means, the life of the Christian is in private and personal devotion and study of the scriptures and familiarization with the scriptures. And when things are puzzling or difficult or hard, we retreat to the scriptures for comfort, for guidance. But it is also to govern the life of the church. So that when we face decisions, when we face perplexity, when we face challenges, need to know the direction we should go, we start together from the word of Christ. When we need to understand what it means to be the church, we come together collectively, and we reinforce each other in our growth by studying and living the word of God together. And you'll notice as well, supported and strengthened by worship, by singing. We're few in number, but even this morning, Peggy, our singing is alive. And that is to your credit, and it's to God's glory that we encourage one another with songs and hymns and spiritual songs to the Lord. But the word of God dwelling richly among you. My last question. If you had to pick one verse from all of this, what would it be? Well, I would answer my question to me with another question. I would say, well, it depends on what you're looking for. Because I have two, the first and the last. Since you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. If you want a summary, that's it. Since you've been raised with Christ, since the old has gone and the new has come, focus on the Lord Jesus. Be guided by him. Be like him. Make him your priority. That's the implication of the resurrection. That's what it means to be Christians, people who have been buried with Christ through faith and raised with Christ through faith to new life. Live that life. That's my summary verse. Set your hearts on things above where Christ is. Live the values of his kingdom. Display the character of the Creator God. But if it's a kind of a motto that you want, then I would go to verse 17. And whatever you do, in word or deed, Do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Whatever you do. This is another of Paul's hints that we're very much rooted in a physical, hurting, needy world. And we're here to live for the kingdom. We're here to participate in the kingdom and expand it. We prayed this morning, "Thy kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." How do we suppose that happens? How do we suppose that God answers our prayer made every time we worship together, other than through us? Your kingdom come. Live in my kingdom, my child. Do my will, do my purposes. And whatever that is, at whatever stage of life we are, still to discover what that is, we're in the middle of it. We may feel that we're not very useful anymore because of our years. Whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name and for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. As I was at one point preparing for this message, I was listening to Bach. I know, but I really love Bach. In fact, you played some Bach this morning, I think, didn't you, Peggy? Or close to, maybe not, but you have, and I bet you will again. Everything that Bach wrote, it is said, he dedicated to the greater glory of God. Because he just knew, and it was as a matter of faith and of conviction, the implications of the resurrection, that everything he wrote, he dedicated to God. He did in the name of and for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm no Bach, but as a motto for my life, whatever you do in word or deed, do it in the name of and for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. God, our Father, we thank you for your love in Jesus. We thank you that he came alive again after paying our price. We thank you and we humbly accept and we pray that you will help us to work out this reality, that our being your followers is not just a matter of our salvation. It is a matter of living for you. It is a matter of living like you. It's a matter of making you our priority, our Lord. And so we give ourselves to you and ask that more and more in our lives, this will be true. And we ask it through Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And we'll continue with prayers of the people as Nancy comes.
Before we pray, I just wanted to say that this is often the point in the service where we would normally, pre-COVID, be doing the offering. And I just wanted to say a few words of thanks and blessings. Thank you for your contributions. If you have something with you today here in the church and would like to deposit something in the plate at the table at the front, your gift would be most graciously accepted. Thank you. So now let us pray. Thank you, God, for your unconditional love for us. Thank you for the amazing love you have shown us through the life, death, and resurrection of your only Son, Jesus. In this special time of prayer, we know that you are listening and you are here with us now. Open our hearts and minds that we might hear your will for us and be guided by the Holy Spirit. Gracious God, we have so much to be thankful for. You have blessed our lives in many ways. We live in comfortable homes. Most of us are surrounded with family members who love and care for us. We are privileged to worship here at St. Stephen's within a community of believers with whom we share our faith journeys. We are ever so grateful today to once again be led in worship by Ian Shugart. Thank you, Lord, for the summer season and warmer weather. We are grateful for the time we can spend outdoors, inspired by your creation. We thank you for blue skies, warm breezes, cool waters, colorful flowers, green fields and forests. Thank you for summer's sounds, too. Cicadas when it's hot, mourning doves in the evening, crickets at night. These things are precious to us. We are thankful for the slower pace the warm summer brings that coaxes us to rest, leaving us rejuvenated for the rest of the year. May this more peaceful and quiet time help bring us closer to you. Thank you for the gift of Gracefield Christian Camp that so many people enjoy. We pray today for its leaders, that they may bring campers and visitors closer to you, and in so doing, find their own lives are enriched by faith. As we think about the wonder of creation and the blessing of summer, we pray for people in other places who have been suffering under abnormally severe weather conditions, like extreme heat, flooding, and wildfires. We pray for their safety and for the safety of first responders who come to their rescue. Help us to be better stewards of the world we live in, your creation, to help reduce the impacts of climate change. We pray, Lord, for people who are suffering today. We pray for those who are sick, in hospital, or recovering from surgery. We pray for those dealing with serious illnesses. May they be blessed with your healing power and restored to good health. Lord, we lift up to your care people who are anxious about their health, perhaps waiting for test results or to be seen by a doctor or waiting for treatment, not knowing what the future will bring. May they be comforted. We pray, Lord, for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Some are grieving recent losses, while others grieve losses from many years ago. May they feel your presence and be comforted. We pray for people who are lonely and those whose relationships with family members or friends are strained. We pray for people, for families that are separated from their loved ones by distance or circumstances beyond their control. We pray too for people who are suffering today because of mental illness. Bless all those who are suffering. May they feel your presence, be uplifted by your love, and be granted peace. We pray for peace and harmony in our community, in our country, and in our world. We think especially of the war in Ukraine and pray for world leaders, governments, and the many people who are working towards a peaceful resolution of this conflict. We pray for Canada's Indigenous communities who are seeking acknowledgement of their long history of suffering and who want reconciliation with the rest of the country. God, help those who are working to expose the truth, to help with the recovery from the horrible atrocities committed to Canada's First Nations. Thank you for your infinite and unfailing love. Thank you for being with us when we struggle and when things go wrong. Sometimes we are overwhelmed. Teach us to always turn to you in times of trouble. Thank you, God, for listening to our prayers. We offer up this prayer in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. with gratitude. Amen. Perhaps I'll announce the next hymn, but I forget what it is. I think it's 291. Ah, yes, Thou Whose Almighty Word. Please stand if you're able.
Receive this blessing from the pen of Paul. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will do it. Amen.